William wandered home from Bromley Grammar School, running over in his mind the speech from Shakespeare he'd been told to learn by his English master.
Friends, Rome and countrymen, lend me some ears. I come to bury Caesar in his grave.
Suddenly, he spotted a car at the corner of the road, and in the car was a weeping young woman. William stood and gaped. The weeping young woman was astonishingly beautiful, and William, in spite of his professed scorn of the feminine sex, was very susceptible to beauty. William blinked and coughed. The young woman turned sapphire blue swimming eyes to him and gulped.
"Say, kid,"
she said with an American twang and intonation that completed the enslavement of William.
"Say, kid, what's the name of this little old town?"
William was too much confused to reply for a moment. And during that moment, fresh tears welled up in the blue eyes.
"I feel just like nothing. I've lost the way and I've lost the map and I don't know where I've got to."
"Where did you want to get to?"
"Stratford. Stratford-upon-Avon, that Shakespeare guy's place. If I don't do it today, I'll never do it. Everyone I know's done it. And to go back home and say I've not seen Stratford, well, I'd never hold my head up again, never. And I've lost the way and I've lost the map."
She ended in a sob that reduced William's already melting heart to complete liquefaction.
"It's all right."
He didn't mean anything in particular. It was only a vague expression of sympathy and comfort.
"You mean this is Stratford? Oh, how dandy. Do you really mean that?"
Stronger and older characters than William would have decided to mean that when fixed by those pleading blue eyes.
"Yes, this is Stratford, all right."
"Say, kid, I just adore you. Now I've got to see it all just as quick as I can."
She opened the door and jumped down.
"Now the first thing I want to see is Anne Hathaway's cottage. Would you be a real cherub and personally conduct me?"
"Yes, I would."
William did not repent his rash statement. If this vision wished it to be Stratford, it was Stratford. They set off down the road together.
"Is it far?"
"Well, whose cottage did you say?"
"Anne Hathaway's."
"Oh, no, it's not far now."
The lady became confidential. She told him that her name was Miss Burford, Sadie Burford.
"I've always loved this little old country. I've longed so passionately to see Stratford. This is the happiest day of my life."
They turned the bend in the road, and there in front of them was Mrs. Maloney's cottage. Mrs. Maloney lived alone with a dog, a cat, and a canary. She was very old and very cantankerous. William firmly believed her to be a witch. Miss Burford gave a little scream of ecstasy.
"Thatched! This must be Anne Hathaway's cottage."
"Yes, this is it. And there's Anne Hathaway looking out of the window."
"Does an Anne Hathaway still live here?"
"Well, I thought that's what you said."
"Well, I meant the one who lived here hundreds of years ago."
"Well, she'll be dead by now."
"But if she wanted an Anne, whatever it was, she should have one.
There's another living there now."
"Oh, how dandy. A descendant, I suppose."
"Oh, yes, yes, that's what she is."
"Well, will you knock or shall I?"
"You don't want to go right in, do you?"
"I sure do."
"I wouldn't if I was you. She's awfully bad-tempered, Mrs. Maloney is. I mean, Anne, what you said is."
"But I must go in. People do, I know."
"But she's mad. She's sort of forgotten her name. She sort of thinks she's someone else. It's best from outside. It's not anything like as nice inside as it is outside."
"But I've known people who've gone inside."
She advanced boldly and knocked on the door. William stood in the background, palely composed, but ready to flee if necessary. The door opened a few inches and Mrs. Maloney's wrinkled face appeared round it. At the sight of William, it became distorted with rage. She growled,
"You little pesty!
Could I just look inside your historical cottage, Miss Hathaway?"
"Hysterical yourself! And me name's Mrs. Maloney, I'll have you to know."
Miss Burford turned to William with a sad smile.
"Poor woman."
Then she entered the kitchen. Miss Burford looked round the old-fashioned cottage, the old dresser and the flagged floor, with a sigh of rapture.
"How lovely. How perfect. But I had an idea there were more things in it."
"There were a lot more things, but they had to take them away when she got like this."
"What's he saying?"
"Nothing, nothing."
Miss Burford, throwing dignity to the winds, followed William's already fleeing figure.
"Poor woman. She's sure plumb crazy. But I can say I've seen it now. That's all I wanted to do."
She took from her pocket a little notebook, opened it, and ticked off Stratford and Anne Hathaway's cottage.
I suppose there aren't any other of his folks about the place, kind of descendants, you know?
There's me. I'm one of his folks.
He was secretly aghast when he heard himself say that. But he merely continued to gaze at her with his most ingenuous expression.
Well, now, isn't that just luck? You're one of his descendants? Fancy that. I guess I was sure lucky to strike you first, Kohoff. What's your name?
William.
Of course. After him, of course.
When Miss Burford returned home, she gave a little lecture on her English travels. She told of her visit to Anne Hathaway's cottage, whose present occupant was very old and suffering from senile decay. She told how, in the same town, she met a descendant of Shakespeare.
It was wonderful, wasn't it?
Her lecture was a great success. That Christmas, one Christmas card was sent to William that never reached him. It was sent from America and was addressed to Master William Shakespeare, Stratford-upon-Avon, England.